A special welcome to resource person CA Murali J for accepting our invitation to take second day sessions of this program with his busy schedule. I would like to say few words about today resource person. CA Murali J is a fellow member of Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. He is in practice for the past 31 years. He is also an expert committee member of Hindustan Chamber of Commerce for the past 15 years. And he was the chairman of Indirect Tax Committee of Chamber for the year 2019-20. He is also co-chairman of VAT Sales Tax Committee of Andhra Chamber of Commerce for the past 10 years. He was the president of Association of Chartered Accountants Chennai for the year 2018-19. He is a eminent faculty for indirect taxes for Continuous Professional Educational Committee, ICAI, New Delhi. He is a recognized GST trainer by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. He is a currently visiting faculty in the Top Training Institute of Commercial Taxes Department. Such a personality today with us, I request all the participants make use of his intellectual skill knowledge. Then I welcome for the second day session our participants from across the nation. Once again, I welcome everyone. Thank you. I request today resource person to take this session.
Yes sir, I am going to start. Namaskar, okay. Wherever you are, have a warm good morning to you all. Today we are going to see supply, a very interesting topic and the important lifeline of the GST. You love to know this in order to decide the taxation, where, when and how. GST per se is a very interesting act. And many of the people say it is indirect tax. But I will say it is a tax directly related to the business. It is just like having the marriage. When you are in the marriage, you will be controlled by your spouse in everything. Similarly, the GST will control you in all aspects of business. Say for example, earlier before the introduction of GST, you can have your credit policy. But as per the GST Act, you will have to have credit policy only for 180 days. If you are not making the payment within 180 days, then you will lose your input tax credit. You will lose the input tax credit. So it is better always to enjoy GST. If you are enjoying GST, you can do wonderful things in your life. Because when you don't like a product, you will have to enjoy the product. When you enjoy the product, over a period of time, you will develop liking. I am in the practice for the law from 1988. So approximately about 30 to 33 years I am in the practice. The practice is not a foolproof for everything. When I started my practice, I was not getting enough direct tax cases. So I thought I will create a place where I will be a master work period of time. And at that same time, I got the break in the indirect tax. So based on that, I have developed my practice on indirect tax. And I am a well-known faculty all over India. Even today also, I am going to address for the certification course of Chartered Accountants India for the Chartered Accountants, not for the students. So wonderful morning to you all. The supply per se will decide the transaction of sale, transfer, barter, made or agreed to be made for a valid consideration by a person in the course of furtherance of business. This is somewhat different. In the earlier regime of VAT, your sale of goods act was playing the vital role. When you want to conclude a sale, there should be three ingredients: buyer and seller, valid consideration, and transfer of property. But under GST, you are going to assess not only goods but also service. Therefore, the supply is a very interesting topic, because it will decide when to bill, when to have a transaction, and how to pay tax, all the details, and whether to pay interstate sales tax, interstate GST, or intrastate GST. What is interstate GST? When I am in Tamil Nadu effecting transfer to Karnataka, it is interstate transaction. In this transaction, I will have to pay tax of IGST, integrated GST. I will have to pay. For example, I am in Chennai effecting sales or effecting some transaction to Mr. Jagadeeswaran. In that case, I am sending the goods to goods to Coimbatore. It is intra-state transaction, which will have two levies. One share for central government, it is called as CGST. Another share for state government, it is called as SGST. I thank the organizers for giving us the wonderful opportunity of meeting you all. And wherever I am going to give example, I will use the names which are known to me, like Dr. Jagadeesan. So kindly don't mistake me, because when you give the name, the other party will easily understand. So the transaction is, what is sale? Sale is when I effect a transaction, when I give the cream saver like this to Mr. Jagadeeswaran, I charge him 2,500 plus 18% tax. Then it is a contract of sale. So it will be accessible under intrastate, that is CGST and SGST. For example, if our friend Jagadeeswaran is giving something in back, instead of money, he is giving some condition. So GST says not only money consideration, even the kind consideration will be considered for the transaction of supply. I will explain you this in a simple way. When GST was introduced in our country, the GST was introduced for the first time. But if you assume I have a company branch at Singapore where GST is imposed. So in that case, what I am doing is, I am asking my person from Singapore to work out a software for me. Then he prepares a software for billing the transaction and to account the GST. Then in that case, if I have purchased the software from local person, I would have paid some tax to the local government. Similarly, this transaction is done within my branch. So I will have to ascertain some cost for this. If the reverse charge mechanism under section 9(4) is in force, I will have to pay reverse charge tax on this. Why? Because the transaction I have received without any consideration, and they will have to bill me the transaction, and I will have to make the payment accordingly. Then wonderful provision, the exchange of goods is also liable for taxation. And when I hand over a license to you, say for example, I have a ground of two, I have a bigger ground, two grounds. So I want entering into a joint venture agreement with my builder, and I transfer the right to develop to him. For that right to develop, I need to pay tax. It is 18%. and if I am getting rental income, say rental income is in the form of commercial rental. What is commercial rental? When I'll lease out my place for a business, they will be paying money. Whenever they pay money, the money is liable for GST at the rate of 18%. I will have to charge 18%, and whatever I have charged will become the input tax credit for the person who pays the money. And leases, what is lease? In the S2L regime, when I want to lease my bulldozer to Mr. Satyanarayanan for doing work in his farm, if I send my driver and if I use my fuel, then I am not handing over the full right to Mr. Satyanarayanan to do the bulldozing work in the farm. So the effective control is only with the lessor. In this case, I will charge VAT on. When I hand over the full vehicle to him and he uses his own fuel and his own driver, in that case it becomes a service tax liability, he will pay tax. But now the VAT and the service tax have merged or subsumed in the GST. So in that case, the leasing is taxable under the GST at the rate of 18%. Then you have disposal. When I dispose my business as a going concern, what is going concern? If Mr. Satyanarayanan wants to acquire my business as it is, as on date, as a going concern, what I will do, we will enter into a memorandum of understanding and I will value the business. I will charge him the rate what mutually agreed between us. He will take all my assets and liabilities in total. If that being the case, it is called as disposal of the business. If it is a going concern concept, whatever input tax credit I am having on the credit ledger on the particular day of conversion, Mr. Satyanarayanan can take up the available input tax credit. So the business may be transferred as it is, or it may be agreed to transfer. In that also it will affect a transaction for a valid consideration. Consideration may be in money or in kind, both are acceptable by a person, and in the course of furtherance of business, that is, whenever I effect a transaction during the course of my business, it is liable to be assessed under GST. I will use an example. Say, for example, in our culture, when a person is getting married to a girl, the girl's family will give some dowry to the boy's family. The dowry is a consideration. If it is accounted for, it is liable for taxation under GST. Why? Because it is not in the exemption list or in the nil rated list. So under GST, everything is liable to be taxed. You cannot say to your son or daughter that I have grown you to this stage by spending so much of money. If you say so, it is liable to be taxed. So better we will live with the GST, enjoy GST, and we will do the needful under GST. Then we are coming to import of service. What is import of service? When for a valid consideration, I transfer some service to a foreign country. You can take this way. Say, for example, I am getting a software from Singapore for doing some business in India. It is for the furtherance of my business. So it is, I am the person who is in furtherance of business receiving the services from Singapore. So it is called as import of service. Section 2, subsection 11 of GST, IGST Act defines import of service means supply of any service where the supplier of service is located outside India, recipient located inside India, and the place of supply is supply of services is in India. Because from Singapore he is sending the software to my Indian branch. So the receipt of the service is in India. It is called as import of service. The supply normally is decided or divided as per schedule, as per taxability, as per execution, as per nature. And the important part here is you should know what is composite supply and what is mixed supply. Why you should know what is composite supply, what is mixed supply? Because to decide the transaction, you have to know. For example, I am traveling by Shatabdi Express from Chennai to Bangalore. When I book my ticket, they will book my ticket along with the food what they are giving. I may not like the food and I may not taste the food. Even though I am not tasting the food, I will have to pay for the food. The travel by air conditioned coach is liable for tax at rate of 18%. The food what they provide is liable for 5%. The composite supply means when one or more naturally binded services are taken together, the principal service will decide the tax for the subsidiary service. So here the principal service is moving in the train, Shatabdi Express, and the ancillary service is getting the food. So I will have to pay for the food at the rate of 18%. Now somebody will say, now you can avoid taking food in the train, so your cost will be reduced. What is mixed supply? Mixed supply is wonderful concept. When two or more not naturally bundled transactions are taken together, the highest rate will apply to all the transactions. That means Mr. Jagadishwaran, our coordinator. So I am giving him one fruit bouquet. I have purchased the fruit bouquet for 2000 rupees. Wonderful fruits, all that. And by that time, I heard from my friend that he likes Cadbury's chocolate. I am enclosing in the bouquet one small Cadbury's chocolate for the value of 10 rupees. What is the total value now? 2010. Out of this, 2000 is agricultural product, not liable to be taxed. Whereas 10, that is the Cadbury's chocolate enclosed is taxable at 28%. Now, I will have to pay tax on the entire 28%. So, definitely don't mix the transaction. Why I am saying this transaction to you? During our festival days like Deepavali or Christmas or Pongal or any time, the businessman will offer, if you purchase soap, you will get bucket free. The rate is included. You will have to pay the soap rate for, or whichever is higher, you have to pay for the mixed supply. So this is wonderful definition. And unless you know the composite supply and mixed supply, I will repeat once again, composite supply is naturally bundled two transaction or more transaction, which are taxable transaction taken together, the principal service rate will apply to the ancillary service. Then the mixed supply, when the unnaturally bundled transaction are taken together, in that case, the highest rate will apply to all the product. So that is the definition of mixed supply. What is intrastate and interstate? Intrastate is the transaction within the same state. For example, I am in Chennai and Mr. Jagadishwaran in Coimbatore. I am effecting sale of this flight changer to him for a value of 2,500 along with the tax of 18%. So this is a transaction between me and Mr. Jagadeeswaran within the state of Tamil Nadu. Out of the 18%, I will charge 9% as CGST, 9% as SGST. If assuming my another friend, Mr. Giri, who is in Bangalore, purchased this flight changer from me for a price of 2,500 plus 18% tax, what I will do? I will charge 2,500 plus 18% IGST, that is integrated GST, I will charge. The interesting concept of GST is the tax will go to the place where it is utilized. By book entry, it will go to the place where it is utilized. In before the that is from the date of independence and up to 1/7/2017, there were only 5 to 6 states which were manufacturing. All other states were enjoying the manufacturers of 5 to 6 states. So if you take up Chennai, Tamil Nadu, or Maharashtra, or you take up Punjab. In those places, the roads will be very nice. Whereas there are underdeveloped places where the advancement of science have not reached. In those places, there may not be any proper road. Whereas in Chennai and other places, it will be you can see skyscraper and other very very big buildings and modern amenities you can enjoy. So for that. The erstwhile tax was manufacturer-based tax. And the GST is recipient-based tax. What is recipient-based tax? When the end user gets the benefit. For example, a car is manufactured in Hyundai Motors in Sriperumbudur. It is sold to Punjab. The car is taken to Punjab and sold. From they have raised the invoice from Chennai. It is a IGST invoice to Punjab. In that case, the benefit of this transaction will travel to Punjab and it will not be with Chennai, that is Tamil Nadu. And even in the transaction within the state, there is one portion of share to be given to central government and another portion is only for state government. If you can recall, in the earlier period, when GST was introduced, every state made a human cry for the compensation to be received. Now, no one is claiming the compensation. Why? Because they were not expecting tax from the excise people and the service tax people. Now they get plenty of tax. Even the share is reduced. Even though the share is reduced, they get plenty of tax, and because of that, they get more revenue. And therefore, what they say, they don't want any compensation from the central government. But during the COVID period, the business coming to standstill, now they will ask for the compensation which they have not received earlier. Then, as per the taxability, it is when the goods are taxable and the rate of tax is mentioned in the first schedule, then it is taxable goods. Very interesting definition is the goods should be finding place in the HSN code under the list schedule 1 of the state list or central list. Certain goods may have state liability, certain goods may have central liability. You will have to check that. Then the rice, which is an agricultural product, is exempted from tax. Therefore, agriculturists need not register under GST. The rice which is bought from the agriculturist is sold as it is. It is exempted from tax. If by chance I purchase rice and I make a trademark Taj Mahal brand Basmati rice, if such being the case, I will have to pay 5% tax. Then there is one more definition called nil rate. What is nil rate? They have provided for taxation, but due to notification issued, it is not liable to be taxed. You can take the example of hospital. All the services in the hospital are liable to be taxed. And the tax rate was given, and the HSN code and the service tax code was given to them. But a notification was issued before the introduction of GST, made the entire operation is exempted one. So it is nil rate. For example, the ambulance service done by the hospital is taxable, but due to the notification, it is not taxable at time at present, and it is called as nil rate. The services of doctors are also taxable, but it is by the notification, it is not taxable now. Whereas, if the doctor is doing cosmetic surgery for an artist or any other person, it is liable for taxation. The necessities are not liable for taxation. Cosmetics and other related activities are liable for operation taxation. What is zero rated? Wonderful definition. The zero, why they have called it as a zero rated? I will explain. The zero rated sales include your export sales, sales to exporter, SEZ sales. So I hope the related party transaction we have completed, and this slide will come back only on later part of the valuation rules. So we will go through once again whatever missed. You need not worry that we are going to miss something. Every slide will have continuity, so you will not miss anything. Only thing is, you will have to listen to my entire PowerPoint presentation. The gift given to the employer by the gift given to the employee by the employer can be exempted, provided if it is below 50,000 rupees. If it is above 50,000 rupees, then it will be liable to be taxed. Up to 50,000 per employee per year is given in the act. Then comes a distinct person. I have explained the distinct person, that I have a head office in Chennai, that is in the state of Tamil Nadu. Then I have branches in Kerala, Karnataka and Pondicherry. Pondicherry is a union territory, and I have the registration number with my PAN number. The state code for Tamil Nadu is 33, and my PAN number ABCDE1234F, and the first number, so 015. Then comes Kerala, it is 025. Then comes Karnataka, it is 03, and Pondicherry 04. But provided in this example, the state code for Kerala is 32, for Karnataka is 29, and for Puducherry or Pondicherry it is 34. So the number may change, but everything will be accounted for in the single PAN, that is ABCDE1234F. It is a Pan India company, so I have branches in 4 states. Even though it is a different registration, all the branches are taken as a distinct person, and it is liable for separate transaction. Even though I get some goods from my Kerala branch, I will have to pay the tax and claim input tax credit. So this is the important definition of distinct person. And section 7.1c talks about a transaction between principal and agent. Supply of goods on behalf of principal by the agent. So if the principal and the agent are in the same state, only the principal will account the transaction. Agent will do on behalf of the principal and account the transaction in the books of principal. If they are in different state, agent will have a separate registration number and he will collect the goods from principal and effect sales in the respective state and report it to the respective state government and pay tax accordingly. Then comes related persons or establishments outside India. Import of services, taxable person for furtherance of business. I have given the example of software getting, that is the, when the GST was introduced, the software of my branch in Singapore prepared and sent me the software for accounting and raising of bills. So that service is an import of service. And both the companies are established under the different countries and they are distinct person and it is for the furtherance of business, therefore it should be liable for taxation. Then come to activities specified in Schedule 2 treated as either supply of goods or service. So we will go one by one, transfer, land and building, treatment or process, transfer of business assets, supply of services, composite supply, supply of goods. The transfer of goods. What is the transfer? Say, for example, I have a car and I want to sell the car. I am selling the car to an unknown person who is Mr. X. So when I transfer the car, I will have to register the car in his name. So it is supply of goods. And whenever I give right to my friend Mr. Y to use the car for the for doing the business of lending or whatever business he is doing, in that case I am giving the right to use to my friend Y. So it is supply of service. And whenever the title is changed on future date, it is supply of goods. So you have to see the difference. Say, for example, when I effect sale to Mr. X, I have registered the vehicle. But when I am giving the car to Mr. Y on right to use the car, he collects money and he gets income in that. Then on the future date, when I want to sell the car to Mr. Y, it is supply of goods. And I can transfer the right to him by registering. The right in goods, the transfer of right in goods is called as services. That means all the services are taxable at 18%. When I rent my car for the leasing activity, I will have to collect 18% on the value and remit it to the government. The person who has borrowed the vehicle pays 18% tax, can claim it as input tax credit in the accounts. So whatever they are doing, they can do business accordingly. Land and building. The land and building, the lease, tenancy, easement, license to occupy is our group under service. The lease rent is called as service because it is taxable at 18% if it is commercial purpose. If it is renting purpose, it is not liable to be taxed, it is exempted. So whenever the house is let out for residential purpose, it will not attract tax and it will be a exempted item. Whereas if it is given for a commercial purpose, doing a business, or having an office in that place, then it is liable for taxation at the rate of 18% because all services are 18%. Treatment or process. The beautiful example of job worker. The job worker normally will not pay tax under any act. In the doing the S2I regime, when the officer asks for tax, that is when the excise officer go and meet the job worker for tax, he will say, "Sir, I am doing a manufacturing activity. I have not crossed the threshold limit, so therefore I will not be liable for taxation." Then when immediately the service tax authority goes, he says that, "Sir, you have not understood the concept. I am doing a manufacturing activity. since my turnover have not crossed the threshold limit, I am not liable to pay tax under excise. So therefore, I am not liable to pay tax under service tax because I am doing manufacturing activity. Then when VAT officials will go and meet the job worker and ask for the details, he will say, sir, I am only converting the work of my principal. And they are giving me the raw material and converting it and giving the finished product. For this, it is not liable to be taxed because it is only a service. And I have not reached the service threshold limit, therefore I am not liable to service tax. By this, they will normally avoid tax, but under the GST, they cannot avoid, so they will have to pay tax when the conversion charges what they receive exceeds the value or that is exceeds threshold limit, they will have to register. Yeah, important difference between the erstwhile job worker and the present job worker is to be understood by everyone. The job worker in the erstwhile regime of VAT or excise or service tax cannot supply material. They will have to convert whatever received from the head office or from the principal. They will have to convert that into a finished product and give the finished product for usage to the other person. But in the present scenario, apart from the goods received from the principal, they can also add some more goods, and whatever they have added, the value is included in the conversion cost, and they will have to pay 18% tax irrespective of the commodity what they have used. So the job worker now liable for taxation for when they conversion charges exceeds 20 lakhs during the year. Transfer of business asset. Transfer or disposal of business asset with or without consideration is supply of goods. When I sell the computer in my office to Mr. X, it is a transaction of sale and he will pay the consideration. When I sell the asset like that, I will have to collect the respective tax on the asset. If it is a scrap, I will have to collect scrap tax and remit it to GST. Then usage or making available business of goods. Then another case is what I have told, the when the business is taken over by the third person without any consideration. The consideration is net assets minus net liability. They have collected the taken over the business as a going concern. In that case, the transaction value is what they have paid. When there is a memorandum of understanding, the input available in my account can be taken over by them. Usage or making available business goods for other than the business purpose supply of service. So when I use my car to my friend for his personal use, then it becomes a personal and I am liable to pay supply of service because when I lent the car for a consideration, it is to be paid to the government. Then closure of business, supply of goods, exempt if business is transferred as going concern, exempt if business is carried on by a respective representative of the erstwhile organization. But for claiming exemption, there should be a memorandum of understanding which they will show the assets taken over and liabilities which are also taken over, and total value of assets and liability will be mentioned in the memorandum of understanding, and by that they can take over the asset and carry over the whatever input tax credit available in the supply of services. Renting of immovable property is a service. When it is a commercial rent, it is liable for taxation. When it is a residential rent, it is not liable for taxation. Then construction, addition, alteration, replacement or remodeling. Consideration received before issuance of completion certificate. It is liable for taxation. Say for example, I am a builder. I develop a plot and I develop a plant in that. In that case, If I sell the flat after completion of the flat and after receiving the completion certificate from the local authority or from the authorized valuer, I need not pay tax for the building because it is a sale of immovable asset. Immovable asset is not liable to be taxed. Whereas if I collect money during the course of transfer, during the course of construction, if I get money in the installments, then for that installments I will have to pay tax accordingly. And if it is a work contract, the rate of tax is 18%. If I purchase a flat, it can be 5% without input tax credit of the person, or it can be 1% for the when it is recognized by government for housing and temporary transfer of use of intellectual property. It is a wonderful provision. When I transfer my intellectual property, for example, if I prepare PPT and give it to you for use in your commercial operation, then I am transferring my intellectual right to you. If for the intellectual right, I will have to collect 18% tax from you, and I will have to remit 18% to the government. Development, design, program, etc. of information technology of software is also liable to be taxed. The software is in the S2L regime. The service tax people claimed it as service tax item. Then the VAT people claimed as VAT. It is liable for VAT. So there were two taxes for software. One from the central government and one from the state government. And now it has changed. There is only one tax for the software which is sold by the company. And the software, if it is a self-made software, then the rate of tax will differ. Refrain from act. Tolerate an act. For example, I am in a partnership firm with a company, and my specialty is advertising. If I leave the company, they will ask me not to advertise for anyone at least for a period of 1 year. For that, they will pay me some money. When they pay money for not doing an act or refrain from doing an act, it is called as a remuneration for me for not doing that. That is also taxable under GST. Transfer the right to use the goods. That is leasing. Leasing is the ownership is only with me. The use of the goods by the other person who has got the lease. The composite supply. What is a composite supply? When there is a good and services, it is called as composite supply. Work contract is one of the example of the composite supply because you are doing the construction of the building. You are doing the fabrication, completion, erection, installation, fitting out, improvement, modification, repairs and maintenance, renovation, alteration or commissioning of any immovable property wherein the transfer of property of goods. Whereas goods are in the same form or is involved in the execution of the contract. Supply of food and drink is also called as a composite supply. Normally, they group the food and drinks. The drinks here means soft drinks or cool drinks, whatever case may be. It is not the alcohol which is included in the VAT item, not in the GST. Alcohol is not coming under the GST, and also the petrol is not coming under, petrol diesel is not coming under GST. The tax paid on alcohol will be equal to 70% or 90% as the case may be as per the state law. So, when they come under the GST, the state will get a share of only 28% maximum. Therefore, they are not allowing the transaction to come into the network of GST. Madam, video call ended now, madam. Hello, sorry, madam. Supply of goods by unincorporated association of individuals or body of individuals to members for cash deferred payment valuable consideration. It is club is giving the materials. Club is giving the material to the members. Normally, when the club is giving the goods to the members, it is not liable to be taxed because they share the ownership of the club. Now it has been defined under the GST that supply of goods is liable to be taxed. Liable to be taxed under valuable consideration. The third schedule is very important. It is activities, neither supply of goods nor supply of services. Wonderful definition. These transactions normally will not be liable to tax elsewhere in the schedule. So, therefore, we will have to see one by one. It is very important. Services by an employee to the employer. The employer employs a staff to do the work. When they are doing the work, they are compensated by the amount of remuneration. The employment agreement will give the details of work to be performed. And based on that, based on the promotion or whatever increment given to the associate, that is to the individual, they will take more responsibility in the business conduct. So, services by an employee to the employer is neither a service nor a good, cannot be assessed. Services by court, tribunal, MPs, MLAs, chairperson, member, director of central government, state government, local authority, etc. Whatever they does is not liable to be taxed under GST because it is neither a service nor a good. And services of funeral, burial, crematorium, mortuary, transportation of deceased. This is a wonderful provision. They have given exemption to the funeral services under the present act of GST. In the earlier regime of VAT, it was not so. One of my client, who is the only client, only registered person, who is a funeral undertaker for the dealing with the funeral undertaking work. What happened during 1986, there was a new introduction called the work contract. Under that, everything can be a work contract. The tailor stitching at the cloth is also a work contract under that. What my client have done at those period is, whenever they have received a notice from the department, they have included that notice in the disposal for work contract cases available in the state of, that is in the court of Madras High Court. They have included that. So after a period of nearly 18 years, they got a judgment from the court. Before introduction of service tax, the judgment said it is a composite service or bundle of services given together by a client. So the bundle of services is the getting the body from the hospital by ambulance, then having the preservative box in the house, then preparing the the box for the body to be rested. Then it is taken to church for offering prayer. Then from the church, it is going to the crematorium or to the burial ground where it will be buried and given rest. The entire service was given as a bundle of service and it is a full project of the association. Then we were paying taxes on the wherever goods have not suffered taxes, like the stars which were embedded in the coffin box, we paid the tax. Likewise, the items which have not suffered tax, we were paying tax. After the 18th year assessment is over, the officer, that is the audit person, called me and said, "Sir, there is a evasion of tax in this case." I said, "Yes, sir, correct. There is evasion of tax in this case." Then he said, sir, why can't you give me the details about how to collect tax on this? I said, you take one square paper, sir. You go to the Kilpak cemetery where my client is doing the cemetery work. Every Tom there will be the name. You can write the name and issue the notice to the person who is sleeping there. So you can give notice like that to everybody. The person who got the benefit of the service is sleeping. You cannot collect from any other person. So I said like this. Then he was a bit angry with me and said, sir, you explain in a proper way. Then I told him, he was having a cool drink bottle before him. I just asked him, what is the rate of tax for the cool drink? In those days, the rate of tax for the cool drinks was 16%. He said 16%. Then I asked him another question, what is the rate of tax for the bottle? Because he was having in a pet bottle. Then he was shocked by my question. He said, you are a chartered accountant, you should know all these things. The rate of tax for the main product will apply to the packing material. Immediately I told him, my main product is dead body. It is not liable to be taxed. Whatever I pack is not liable to be taxed. Now you will have to give me refund of whatever taxes we have paid. Then immediately he said, he asked the assessing authority to said, don't bring these type of persons to me because they are very intelligent and they want to take everything in their side. And luckily after that the assessment was not reopened because what I have explained is the correct explanation. When the main product is exempted, whatever packing material you use is also exempted. The same example the officer was saying, the cool drink is in the 16% and the bottle covering the cool drinks, having the cool drinks is also 16%. So wherever you can say like this, there is one phrase in Tamil, that is, it was given by our late Chief Minister Annadurai. The argument of the advocate is a light, where it will clear the darkness in the mind of everybody. So the advocate should be intelligent enough to argue in a proper way. Then comes sale of land and building after issuance of completion certificate. Wonderful definition. The sale of land and building. Here, there is a comma after land and comma is there. You will have to read the punctuation mark in the act very clearly. When the punctuation mark is there, the sentence ends with that, then comes the another sentence. But in the GST definition, it is saying sale of land and comma. That means building is not included. But if you sell the second-hand building along with the land, it is not liable to be taxed because it is the fixed asset. Similarly, if for a new house, say there are now the recession is coming to set. So in this period, the flats promoted are not sold. If you go to OMR, that is OMR road is there in near Gindi, where all the software companies were located. Now all the software are doing work from home. So there is no traffic or there is no person living there except the native of that place. There they have constructed huge towers and most of the towers are vacant. Now they want to sell, they can sell without levying tax on GST. Actionable claims other than lottery, betting, gambling. We will explain one by one in the last slides. Supply of goods under drop shipment. This is a wonderful definition. What is drop shipment? Say for example, I am in Chennai. I place an order in Singapore and ask to deliver the good from Singapore to Russia. The goods will not come to Chennai. It will move from Singapore to Russia. This transaction is drop shipment transaction, and in this type of transaction, if it is effected before 1st February 2019, it is liable to be taxed in India. The act was amended from 1-2-2019. Then in that case, it is not liable to be taxed in India after the 1-2-2019. Then high sea sale or warehouse the boat sales. What is high sea sale? In the estoril regime, if you import a good, the good will come in high sea. See, it will come by sea, and from the bank of the sea, 25 Nottingham miles will be related to the country in which they are landing. So after that, it is called as high sea. High sea means there will be more tide there. When the sale is effected in the high sea, it is not liable to be taxed under the estoril CST Act. Then in 2002, they have amended CST Act to include the custom frontier. Till you take delivery of the goods, when you take delivery of the goods, the bill of entry will be registered in the name of the person who is importing the goods. Till that, if you effect a sale of goods, then it is not liable to be taxed. There are many cases on high sea, and judgments, plethora of judgments were there. And the concept of judgments are very simple. Only when the goods enter the Indian frontier, you are liable to assess the good in the Indian frontier. The sale is effected not in the Indian frontier, but in the high seas. When the sales is effected in the high seas, it is not liable to be taxed in the hands of Indian person, provided there is an agreement of sale and the endorsement of the shipping bills, etc. If that being the case, the entry for the goods will be made by the recipient of the goods. Then he will have his name and account to the person who has imported originally. In such being the case, it becomes the product of the end user, and it is not liable to be taxed because it is not in the Indian taxable territory to be assessed. And the same judgment was amended, and the high sea sale is now exempted in India. That is, if you get the good before getting the bill of entry, you need not pay tax. A very wonderful provision, because the bill of entry is a document which gives title of goods for the landing of the goods in Indian territory. Then only the sale will be accounted for and can be assessed under the GST Act. If you effect sale in the course of before taking delivery or before generating the bill of entry, then it means that you are effecting a sale outside the country and you are not liable to pay tax. This judgment was also recently given. The amendment for this is recently given. You will have to understand. Supply of goods from one place in the non-taxable territory to another place in the non-taxable territory without such goods entering into India. Before 1-2-19, these transactions were liable to be taxed. Why? Because the amendment was made by the Act only retrospective, not prospective. Retrospective means only from 1-2-2019, the amendment can be used. In this example, I am purchasing and I am purchasing from Singapore and asking to deliver the good in Russia. The good will not come to Chennai. It will move in the sea to Russia, or it will move by air to Russia. In this case, there is no GST liability if the transaction is effected after 1st February 2019. If it is effected on 1-7-2017, it is liable to be taxed. So it is only a prospective amendment. Supply of warehoused goods to any person before clearance of home consumption. That is what I have been explaining to you as high sea sales. Before clearing the goods for home consumption, if you effect a sale, the sale is effected not in the Indian frontier, but in the outside the Indian frontier, and not liable to be taxed. This amendment came from 1-2-2019. Before that, if the transaction is effected, in the warehouse, it is liable to be taxed. Supply of goods or supply of services. Activities or transactions to be treated as supply of goods or supply of services. The amendment recently came, it says supply as defined in section 7(1)(a) as complied with. If that being the case, it is a supply of goods or supply of services. Exempted supply, section 2, subsection 47 of CGST Act. The supply which is not taxable as per the CGST Act or IGST Act will be grouped under exempted supply. At times, SGST Act will also exempt the goods in the particular state. So, the exempted goods which are defined in the CGST Act, section 11 or section 6 of IGST Act, it is liable to be exempted from tax. Similarly, when it is exempted under the state act, the taxability will not come on the exempted goods. The easy example for this is rice procured from the agriculturist is exempted from the tax. But for taking the registration, this turnover will have to be added to know the threshold limit of 40 lakhs or 20 lakhs as the case may be. Zero rated supply. For the convenience of YouTube delegates, I am repeating the zero rated supply once again. What is a zero rated supply? It is a taxable supply, export of goods to foreign country, or export of goods, that is a supply of goods to special economic zone or special economic zone developers. These transactions are not taxable under the Act. Why? Because it is coming under the control of our central government. The tax to be levied only in the case of IGST, not on the CGST or SGST. So whatever taxes paid on this account will have to be only IGST, integrated tax, GST, not the CGST or SGST. And wherever you pay tax, for example, there is a document called letter of undertaking. You will have to file the letter of undertaking online in your system by quoting your registration number for the exports you are going to make. When you have filed a letter of undertaking, the export is exempted in the hands of exporter. You will ask me a question. Sir, if I have not filed that LUT, what will happen? Nothing will happen. You will have to pay the rate of tax for the goods under IGST. And whenever you file your customs return, it will be available in the customs website. And the same details should be available in the GST website. If both are tallying verbatimly about the port number, etc., consignment of date, consignment, your vessel consignment details, etc. If it is matching, the customs will refund the 18% IGST what you have paid to the person. You need not file any return for claiming the refund. Why? Because it is automatic provision. When the entry in the customs portal is matching with the GST portal, the refund is automatic. You need not claim for that. You will have to claim for the input for the goods which you have purchased and used in the transaction. For that, you will have to file a return called RFD-01A to the GST officials. GST officials, after verifying your return, will refund the amount to you. What is composite supply? One person in the website, that is the YouTube, asked me, you will have to explain the composite supply and the mixed supply. Now I am explaining composite supply. The composite supply is bundle of services which are offered by the assessee to another recipient. in the bundle of services, say for example, one work is an important work, that is a principal service, and another one is ancillary service. The rate of tax for the principal service will be applicable to ancillary service. In this transaction, the bundle of services should be naturally related and all should be taxable services, which are bundled under conjunction with other in the ordinary course of business. One which is principal supply. Principal supply is the main supply for which you have undertaken the work. I can give you the example of traveling by Shatabdi Express. When you travel by the Shatabdi Express, they will include the rate of food in the ticket value. And the AC coach is liable for GST. So the tax what you pay for the AC coach is 18%. The food rate is 5%. But it is ancillary to the travel. Therefore, both of them could be totally taken as composite supply. And since they are naturally bundled and that you naturally related, it is called as naturally bundled transaction. And you will have to pay tax accordingly at 18%. Mixed supply. Definition of mixed supply is very simple. Any two or more unnaturally bundled transactions are taken together. Then the maximum rate will apply to all the services. Whether the other one is exempted or not, it is not a criterion. The tax levied for the highest rate will be applicable to the full product. So this is what I have explained. I am giving a proof basket to the organizer of the webinar. So in that time I was told that they like chocolate. So I am also enclosing chocolate. The fruit basket is valued at 2000 rupees and the chocolate valued at 10 rupees. I am giving total value of 2010. And the chocolate will be taxable at 28%. Therefore, fruit and chocolate are taxable at totally 2010 rupees is taxable at 28%. Then, as per the execution, intrastate and interstate, when the transaction of the sale effected between a single state, it is called as intrastate. For the intrastate transaction, the taxes collected will be divided equally as CGST claim and SGST claim. For the interstate transaction, it is only integrated tax, that is when the transaction is between two different states, then it is IGST tax will be collected. Supplier in Chennai, recipient in Coimbatore, GST 12%, value of goods 10,000, CGST 6% and SGST 6%, total 11,200. Same example, Chennai supplier, recipient Bangalore, rate 12%, value of goods 10,000, IGST charge is 1,200. The amount charged is under the tax is 1,200, but it is having difference. IGST will go to the state where the goods are consumed. CGST and SGST will go to the state where it is consumed. Intrastate transaction to go to the place where it is consumed. Component of supply, time, place, value, whichever is earlier. Date of invoice, last date to issue invoice, date of receiving payment. Say for example, I have done a work for Bardia University on 10-7-2019. 2020, then I can raise an invoice before 10-8-2020. I have generated the invoice on 10-7-20 and the last date to issue invoice is 9-8-20. Date of receiving payment, I am yet to receive the payment, but I have accounted the invoice in my book because I have given the goods and the movement of goods at the time of removal of the goods. It is given. No movement at the time of delivery. Continuous supply lost each time when the statement is given. Sale on approval when the supply is confirmed after 6 months from the date of removal. So you will have to understand what is sale on approval. It is a concept available for big missionaries. In the big missionary, they will give the missionary to be operated in the factory. They will use the missionary for the production purpose. And after some time, if it is not suitable to them, they will return back the missionary. The time given for giving back the goods without affecting sale is, or without affecting payment of GST is, the goods should be returned back within 6 months. Returned back within 6 months from the date of dispatch. Then continuous supply. I have received an order from Bardiyar University to supply water can. I am supplying water can daily. Daily I am supplying about 100 cans to Bardiyar University. I am given payment only on the last day of the month. So whatever cans I have supplied on the last day, or during the month, I will get the payment. So I will raise the invoice only on the last. I will generate delivery challan for every moment, and generate invoice only at the end of the month, giving the total number of water cans supplied by me. Then the Bardiyar University will make the payment to me. So the last statement where it is given will give the liability for tax. And I am giving you the example of type of supply of the food. Date of supply is 10-7-2019. Last date to issue invoice is 9-8-2019. Date of invoice is 10-8-2019. Date of receiving payment is 15-8-2019. Whichever is earlier should be taken. I have generated invoice only on 9-8-2019. So the time of supply of food is 9-8-2019. And whichever is earlier will have to be taken into account. Next example, 10-7-2019 date of supply. I have raised invoice on 9-8. Date of invoice is 11-7. And the date of payment is 15-8. Whichever is earlier here, 11-7 is the earliest date. So I will have to take it into July month record. Then 10-7-19. Last date 9-8-2019, but I have generated 11-7-2019. Payment received in advance 5-7-2019. Whichever is earlier is 5-7-2019. So I will have to book the transaction in my book as an advance. If it is a good, I need not pay tax on advance received. If it is a service, I will have to pay tax on the services whichever is earlier, received earlier. Reverse charge. What is reverse charge? Wonderful definition. Say, for example, I am effecting a travel, that is, I am going to file a litigation before the High Court against the GST orders passed. So, in this case, I am engaging an advocate, and the advocate is not having registration number because they are exempted from registering under the GST Act. So, what he says, he is asking a fees of 50,000 rupees. I am paying the fees at once, then only he will prepare the reply. So he prepares the reply and files the appeal writ before the High Court of Madras. In this case, when I paid 50,000 rupees on 10-8-2019, I will have to generate a self-generated invoice. In the earlier tax regime, there is a concept called bot note. What is a bot note? When you purchase from an unregistered dealer, you will have to account the transaction in your note, in your book as bot note. That should be serially numbered and continuously numbered, and the value of the goods and the commodity will have to be mentioned in the goods. Similarly, as per the GST Act, whenever you pay to an advocate, you will have to generate self-generated invoice. Based on that, this month you pay tax and next month you can claim the input tax credit. The documentary evidence for claiming the input tax credit is nothing but the self-generated invoice. Then comes 10-7-2018 date of issue of invoice. Last date for the issue of invoice is 9-8. date of receipt of goods is 15-7. Then date of making payment is 15-8. Whichever is earlier is 15-7. So the date of receipt of goods will be accounted for. Kindly note, under GST Act, you will have to maintain stock book. If you are not maintaining stock book, you will not be eligible to claim the input tax credit. How the officer can know this? If they see your tax audit report, if the chartered accountant will give the books of accounts maintained and books of accounts produced for verification. In that, if a stock account is not mentioned, then the input, whatever you have claimed, can be set aside by the assessing authority, because the act says you will have to maintain the details in your stock book. Then the last one, 10-7-2019, last date to ensure the effect is 9-8. Date of receipt of goods is 11-7. Date of making payment, you have made the payment 5-7-2019 as an advance. So in that case, the 5-7 will be the date on which you have effected the transaction. Time of supply of services. All services, you can have 30 days time to generate invoice. You can generate invoice on the same day, or you can get the 30 days period. It is taken from service tax regime. Under service tax, you can have 30 days time to generate an invoice. In case of banking and financial institutions, it is 45 days, because once in 45 days, they will file the return in the prescribed format. For the continuous supply, due date of payment can be identified from the contract. When there is a contract, the contract says every month we will pay, make the payment on the last day. Then that is the day where you are paid. So payment is linked to the completion of an event, and you will have to pay tax accordingly. Due date of payment is not cannot be identified from the contract. Supply of services ceases under a contract before the completion of the supply. That will be the date on which the payment is to be made. Time of supply of services, regular. Date of provision of service, 9-7. Yeah, I can generate invoice on 8-8, but I have generated invoice on 10-7. I have received payment on 10-8. Which is the due date? The due date is 10-7-2019. Next example, date of provision of service is 9-7. 30 days I can generate the invoice 88. Date of issue of invoice 10-8. Date of receipt of payment 10-15-7. Then the 9-7 will be the date on which I have completed. Reverse charge. Date of issue of invoice, document in lieu, 1-7, 60 days from the date of issue, that is I can wait for 60 days, 29-8 is the due date, date of payment 10-8, so 10-8 should be accounted for. Similarly, in the next example, I am generating on 29, I am making the payment, so 29-8 will be the due date for next transaction. Supply without movement, location of the goods, where the goods are located will be the supply. Then supply with movement, place of delivery of the goods. For example, I am effecting sale to Bangalore. I am sending the goods from Chennai to Bangalore. So the movement will be terminated once it reaches Bangalore. Then the transaction it will complete only on the place of delivery. Third party directing the transfer of title. Third party registered premises. For example, I am effecting sale to Mr. A in Delhi. Mr. A in Delhi asked me to supply the goods to C in Calcutta. I am supplying the goods to C's place. I am delivering the goods on behalf of A. In this case, I will generate an IGST invoice on Mr. A, and Mr. A will generate IGST invoice on Mr. C, who is in Calcutta. He will claim input tax credit on my bill. Assembled at site. Where the goods are assembled at site, for example, the air conditioner will be installed in the office. If it is so, the contract will terminate only on the installation of air conditioner. you cannot use air conditioner without insulation. Therefore, the contract terminates only on the installation of the air conditioner. When the say, for example, I am boarding a train at Chennai, the train goes to Delhi, and they load the food items in the Chennai station, that is Chennai Central. They deliver the goods when the train is on the move. Now you can ask me, say for example, the goods loaded in Chennai, I am taking the goods at Andhra Pradesh. If the vehicle is at the train is going to Delhi, within 45 minutes it will cross the Tamil Nadu border. Then it will go out of Tamil Nadu border, it will land in Andhra Pradesh, then it will proceed in further way. In such case, will you, when I get an idli or vada from the train, how will you tax it? You will tax in the place of Andhra Pradesh? It is not so. The tax should be made when the goods are loaded in the train. So when the goods are loaded in the train at Chennai, so therefore the taxation is only at Chennai. All other cases should be determined by council. That is to be given by the council. I am supplying goods from Chennai to Bangalore. So the goods take the lorry route road and they goes to Bangalore. That supply will terminate only when the goods are delivered in Bangalore. Imported into India, location of the importer is the place of supply of goods. That is the natural, no? I am getting the goods from Singapore means the location of the importer, that is I am in Chennai. The person who sends the goods is from Singapore. I receive the goods in India, then it is importer. So export is location outside India. The person who receives the goods should be outside India. The place of supply is the goods going outside India, outside the Indian territory, outside the GST border. Movement of goods by the supplier. Supplier's factory from where the goods are removed, Orissa. Termination of movement, Assam. When the movement is terminated in the Assam, place of supply is Assam. Now the tax will be IGST tax at Orissa. Then Orissa, if I am sending the goods within Orissa, the termination is at Orissa, then the taxation will be CGST, SGST at Orissa. Movement of goods by the recipient. The recipient takes the goods from Kerala to Goa. IGST payable at Kerala. And the terminate at Goa. So it is a transaction between Kerala and Goa. The invoice will be on Kerala and Goa. The recipient takes the goods. If the recipient takes the goods from Kerala to Kerala, then it is CGST, SGST payable at Kerala. Supply involves movement of goods and delivered to a person on the instruction of the third party. Location of the supplier, Sita. Place of supplier of goods, office of Rama. From principal place of Lakshmanan, who instruct delivery to Ram. Place of supply, Sita. Type of tax payable by Sita. In the first location, Ahmedabad is a place of Sita. And place of delivery of goods, office of Ram is Ahmedabad. But principal place of Lakshmanan is Amritsar. So, I will raise invoice, that Sita will raise invoice on Lakshman. So, in that case, it is IGST Ahmedabad. Then Lakshman will generate an invoice on Ram from Ahmedabad to from Amritsar to Ahmedabad. Then he will jar another IGST. Location of supplier, Ahmedabad, and where the goods are required is Amritsar. Principal place of Lakshman, who instructed delivery, Amritsar. Then place of supply, Amritsar. Because it is moving from Allahabad to Amritsar. So IGST to be paid at Allahabad, and the transaction moves from Ahmedabad to Amritsar. So Ahmedabad will pay the tax. Ahmedabad, Bangalore, Bangalore, Bangalore. IGST at Ahmedabad. Ahmedabad, Chandigarh, Udaipur, Udaipur. IGST at Ahmedabad, whatever the transaction is. Here we have to note one thing. The instruction of the third person will ask me to deliver in a different state or in the same state. But the transaction is only interstate transaction. Because the recipient and supplier are two different states. Location of the supplier, Ahmedabad. Place of delivery, Ahmedabad. Principal place of Lakshmanan, Amritsar. Then place of supply of Lakshmanan, Ahmedabad. Then it is IGST at Punjab. Ahmedabad, Amritsar, 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 CST plus GST at Punjab. So it will change the accordingly. Sale of pre-installed DG set. DG set is the generator set. It is installed, the location of the supplier is Delhi. Location of the recipient is Bhopal. Then it is only a transaction of IGST payable at Delhi. Manufacturer of molds by job worker sold to the principal but remained in the job worker's place. Then Tamil Nadu is the location of the supplier. Recipient, location of the recipient, Kerala. Location of the goods, Tamil Nadu. Place of supply, Tamil Nadu. So CGST and TNGST, that is CGST and Tamil Nadu SGST will be applicable. A person who is in Noida has an old car. He wants to sell the old car. He brings the car to Sikkim. So he will have to charge the CGST and SGST if he is a businessman. If he is not a businessman, this will not come into taxation. Installation of weighbridge. Location of the supplier, Delhi. Registered office of the recipient, Bhopal. Installation assembly site, Bhopal. The place of supply, Bhopal. In this case, the tax will be IGST at Delhi and the good will move to Bhopal for installation. Server supplied and installed at the office of a marketing firm, Karnataka. The location of supplier in Karnataka. Registered office recipient, Goa. Installation assembly site, Karnataka. Then place of supply, Karnataka. Karnataka GST will have to be paid. Supply of workstation, Gujarat, Gujarat, Kerala, Kerala. IGST from Gujarat. Supply of goods supplied on board of conveyance, which I have explained. So it will be on the place in which the goods are loaded will be the liability for the transaction. If it is sold on the interstate, it will be IGST. If it is sold on the within the state, intrastate, it is CGST and SGST. Taking goods out of India to the place outside India. Importer bringing the goods into India from a place outside India. Goods imported to India, location of importer. Goods exported to India, location of the supplier. Section 5 provides IGST shall be levied on goods imported into India as per Section 3 of Customs Act. Here you will have to understand one important point. The erstwhile regime, when you import from foreign country, you will have to pay AED and CVD. If you pay AED, you need not pay VAT. If you pay CVD, you need not pay GST. You need to pay the excise act. Now the benefit is given to all. Whenever you import whatever taxes they collect as a customs tariff, it will be customs act. In addition to that, which they were collecting AED, CVD, etc., will be called as IGST. And the IGST will get the input for the person who is importing based on the bill of entry. It will be available in the bill of entry and you can pay tax accordingly or you can take input tax credit in the month in which it is imported to India. Place of supply of goods. Import of goods. Thailand. Location of supply, Thailand. Location of goods, Thailand. Goods supply to Assam. Location of recipient, Assam. Place of supply, Assam. Supplier, China. Location of goods, China. Goods supplied to Kashmir. Then location of the recipient, Haryana. The goods are moving directly to Kashmir first. Then it will go to Haryana. So Kashmir is the place of supply. Karnataka, location of the supplier. Location of the goods in Iran. Goods supplied to Dubai. Karnataka, not an import, not liable to be taxed as per the explanations already made. Then comes export of goods as a location of the supplier Assam, location of goods Assam, goods supplied to Thailand, location of the recipient Assam. But in this case, the Thailand people will be directing the local supplier to give it to Assam for some job work. So in this case, Thailand is the port of supply. Then comes the location of the supplier Tamil Nadu, location of goods Kashmir, goods supplied to China, then location of the recipient in Texas. So the place of supply will be China. Because I generate invoice on China, then China will generate invoice on Texas. Similarly, other examples. A registered recipient. That is, in the beginning I told you there are three important documents to be maintained. One is your registration certificate, next one is your supplier's details, third one is your customer's details. If you have the address of the customer, then location of the recipient will be available to you. That rate of tax will be decided either interstate or intrastate based on the available details. To an unregistered recipient, address of the recipient is not available, location of the supplier. Wonderful definition. Say, for example, one person from Puducherry or Pondicherry is purchasing from my shop in Chennai. I know his address. When I know his address, even though I deliver the goods here, the transaction will be IGST. If he purchases without identifying the number, then it is a local transaction. For me, it is intrastate transaction. The tax paid by the assessee cannot be claimed at his end. Supplier of service and recipient of service, location is in India. Whenever service is provided, say for example, one company in Bangalore asking me to come and do audit of their company at Bangalore. Then the recipient of service is a Bangalore company. The place of service is Bangalore. I will generate invoice from Chennai, that is IGST invoice, I will generate from Chennai. Registered person under this act. Then comes wonderful provisions. The marriage hall or the immovable property like hotel or the port, etc. The service provided will be decided at the point of the location of the property. For example, I am going for an audit in Bangalore and staying in a hotel in Bangalore. I will have to pay CGST and SGST tax for the hotel bill. When I pay CGST and SGST for the hotel bill at Bangalore, I cannot take input tax credit. Even though I give my number, registration number in Chennai, the point of supply is only at Bangalore. Therefore, he will levy tax only under CGST and SGST. Similarly, if I want to conduct marriage of my daughter in Jaipur, I'm going to Jaipur and to conduct the marriage. In that case, the marriage hall is located in Jaipur. For the marriage hall, whatever rent I pay, I will pay only in CGST and SGST. Then for the marriage, I ask a person from Chennai to prepare the cooking, catering for every occasion from Chennai. In that case, the performance is done at Jaipur. Then the CGST and SGST of the respective state will be applicable. If the value is more than 20 lakhs, he will have to register there. Otherwise, he will not register there. The cosmetic surgery and makeup, what is done to a lady, it is based on the performance of the place of performance, not on the place of the assessee. And similarly, when the operation is conducted, it is based on the place at which the operation is conducted. That is, and the hospital which is doing the operation will be the place of supply. Now, the cricket match between England and West Indies for the second test is going on at England. I think at Manchester. The place of the event is Manchester. So, the accessibility is only at Manchester. But since it is outside the territory of our GST, it will not be liable to Indian GST. It will be liable to the British GST if any liability is there. Then I am engaging a professional to perform an art, to perform music concert in the place. He is coming from Tanjavur to my place in Chennai and performing. He will charge me based on the place of event, that is Chennai. He will charge me CGST and HGST. If I ask him to come to Bombay, Tamil Sangam, and they are performing the transaction at Tamil Sangam, means he will have to charge IGST on the bill what he raised. Now you can know the concept of taxation under GST. We are not leaving anyone. So whatever performance you do, whatever income you earn, you pay tax under GST. Transportation of services, registered location of the registered person or unregistered location where the goods are handed over to the transportation will be the place of service. When you are loaded, that is, when you are getting into a bus for transportation of passengers, the embarking place or location of a registered person will be taken as the place of destination. Banking and financial company, where the address of the records of the recipient or location of the supplier, whichever is known to the transaction. If the person is a registered dealer, address or records of the recipient. If the person is not a registered dealer, the location of the bank will decide. Insurance services, location of the registered person or address of the recipient is in the e-book of the supplier. This is where I told you the importance of the second record. Address of the recipient is in the e-book of the supplier. Advertisement services. Wherever the advertisement is made, it is liable to be taxed in the particular state. Location in each state or union territory as the case may be. Telecommunication services. Wherever the tower or antenna is located will be the place of supply. Everyone is having third hand, that is your cell phone. Somebody will be having four hands or five hands. They have two or three cell phones with them. So when you have a postpaid bill, then the postpaid billing address will be the place of supply. If you don't have a postpaid bill, then prepaid, wherever you get the token recharged, the recharging place will become the place of supply. Post contract, place of supply, location of the supplier. Place of supply is POS, location of the supplier is LOS. The Gujarat person, that is Maharashtra person going to Gujarat to do the work. So he is engaging contract service and he get a subcontractor, SC2. The work contractor now will give bill to the party. He can give whenever he is going from Maharashtra to work in the place of Gujarat. He will have to get temporary registration. He will charge only CGST and SGST at the place of supply, that is Gujarat. Then SC1 liable to pay CGST and SGST as LOS and POS are same. Subcontractor effecting transaction in the state of Maharashtra, he will give CGST and SGST. Then the second person liable to pay IGST, that is a subcontractor in Gujarat will pay CGST and SGST, will charge CGST and SGST. Subcontractor in Maharashtra will charge IGST on the transaction. Post contract continued, Gujarat and Maharashtra. Supply of service from Maharashtra. Supply of service from Maharashtra to Gujarat. Then subcontractor provider, one is in Gujarat and two is in Punjab. The transaction where it is completed at Chennai, that is Punjab, Maharashtra, and delivered at Gujarat. In that case, it is liable to be taxed at IGST. SC1, that is subcontractor one who is in Gujarat, will charge IGST. Whereas the subcontractor two who is located at the Maharashtra will charge CGST and SGST on Maharashtra. we are coming into the interesting topic of valuation of taxable supply and the valuation goods. What is valuation? Normally, a valuation is not required when you are effecting transaction to a third person for a valid consideration. If you are effecting transaction to a person who is related to you, then the valuation is required. If you do so, it will avoid the understatement of value. Normally, dealers will try to resort to understatement. Understatement is giving, say, for example, I am supplying worth for 1 lakh. I will bill for 10,000. That is understatement. That is not correct. You have to bill for 1 lakh. And now the present scenario, you have to understand. Your books are maintained by the third party. You are not maintaining your books. So, for example, when you effect a sale of 1 lakh, you have to account for 1 lakh. Then only the input will flow easily to the recipient. If you maintain 10,000 rupees and if you effect sale for 1 lakh, it will create a nuisance to you. Forms the basis of determining the tax liability. Value of supply is equal to transaction value. If it is to the third party, whatever transaction value is there, it will be taken as transaction value. If it is to the related party means the next slide will explain the related parties. It is a party where you will not sell the product at the market price. You will sell the product at a price lower than the market price, and because of that, the other party will gain in the value of what you have transferred. The related parties are directors. If you are selling to your own director, you may not sell at the sale value. You will be selling the goods at the cost value. That is not correct. In that case, the valuation rule will come into force and ask you to book at the higher rate. When there is a transaction between employer and employee, if you are supplying a good to your own employer, you are a manufacturer of table, and your employee wants one table and you are supplying one table to your employee, you will not sell the goods at a normal price. You will give the goods at concessional price. If you are selling to your own family member, you will not sell the goods at the normal price. You will sell it as a lesser price. So in that case, if your own son or daughter purchases your vehicle, you will have to give at least the book value so that the book value will be reasonably accounted for. And there is two partners in a firm. One partner takes the company's car and another partner takes the company's van. For both the items will be transferred at lesser price, and for that you will have to adopt to valuation. The third party is very interesting. One who controls the company. It is a holding company or subsidiary company, as the case may be. Normally, every big company will have 10 to 15 subsidiary companies for the continuous supply of raw material. Otherwise, at times, because of the non-supply of raw materials, they cannot fulfill the production process in time. So what they will do, they will collect the goods and store it in their place. Whenever there is a requirement, they will send it to the manufacturing company. So in this case, the person manufacturing company will control the other subsidiary company. So there is a transaction between the related parties of this type of companies, means the valuation rule will come into force. Transaction value. Price paid or payable, add taxes and duties, cess, etc. Supplier's liability met by recipient. Wonderful provision. For example, I am selling one car to my own partner. And what the partner does is, he is purchasing tires and seats, etc. and using. The liability should have been done by me, but it is done by my partner. In that case, the value will be added with them. Then incidental expenses like commission, packing, etc., it should be added to the cost. interest or late fee penalty paid is also added to the cost. Subsidy is directly linked to the price to be added to the cost, except the subsidies given by central government and state government will not be added to the cost. If this happens, it will be very difficult for the person to value the transaction. Rent on commercial building, 18 lakhs, valuation required. Maintenance charges reimbursed by the tenant. Maintenance charges should be paid by the tenant. If it is reimbursed, means then the company will have to pay tax on the maintenance charges. And for the commercial rent also, the taxes will apply. Refundable advance, there is no valuation required, and municipal taxes were paid for the transaction, there is no valuation. Another important topic is discount. If the discount is given in the, that is when the contract is entered, if the discount is available between buyer and seller or supplier and recipient of the goods, then the discount, if it is given at the time of raising invoice, will reduce the value, or he can issue the invoice and he can give at the target discount. Say for example, I am having a manufacturing unit and I employ a sole selling agent, and I say that sole selling agent, if you cross 1 lakh rupees every month, I will give you another discount of 2%. So that is a discount known to the buyer and seller. Therefore, he purchases accordingly and distributes the product everywhere. So for this, I am offering him extra 2%. That is known to him in the beginning itself. So when it is known to him in the beginning, it need not be reversed. Otherwise, whatever not known to him, given in the discount given, offered, is will be liable for reversal of input tax credit. What is reversal of input tax credit? The original invoice value will bear the total value and the taxes will be charged accordingly. But the discount given will not be reduced. If the discount is subsequently given, then the proportionate portion of the tax in the discount should also be reversed by the assessor. If it is known, you need not do that. Secondary discount. If discount is not known at the time of supply, then no deduction can be made. It is understood from circular that even price revisions are not covered under Section 34. Issues based on financial or commercial credit note given by supplier, is it required on the part of the receiver to reverse the input tax credit? If it is known transaction, if the buyer and seller already decided to have a discount like that, then reversal is not required. If they don't know the transaction at the beginning, then the reversal is automatic. On or before supply of goods, discount only recorded in the invoice and net value is paid. Therefore, it is not liable to be reversed. After supply, discount is in agreement, is linked to the invoice, recipient has not reversed, then there is no reversal required. This is very important provision you will have to understand. In the consumer goods, this type of discount is done very largely. For example, one type of TV will be marketed. A new TV, when it is marketed, the manufacturing company will inform the distributor that if you take 5 pieces or 10 pieces, I will give you extra discount of 10%. So what they will do, they will take the TV, reduce the rate and market the TV. So when they reduce the rate below the MRP, the rate, the purchase rate will be different, sale rate will be different. They will give you discount after some time. The discount is noted and it will be given after a particular period, say month or year, as the case may be. As per the agreement, it will be given. In such a case, you know the discount rate and you have effected the transaction based on the discount available. Therefore, there is no requirement of reversal of input tax credit which you gained on purchase. If it is not so, if it is done after some time, then you are liable to pay reverse your input tax credit. Value of supply of goods or services where the consideration is not wholly money. For example, I am giving one, they say, for example, I have worked for a company and they are yet to make the payment. What they say, we will give, it is a car company. What they say, I will hand over a car to you for the fees which is outstanding to you. You will have to value the transaction. How you will value? Value of supply you will have to take. Then, do you know the market value, open market value? Then, if you know the open market value, that is the value. Say, for example, the company owes me 10 lakhs and they give a car worth 10 lakhs. Then the car value is 10 lakhs. If the value is not known, I will have to see the equivalent value. Equivalent value means the competitor of the same group. If there is no competitor, then I will have to resort in kind, cannot be determined. Then I will have to follow rule number 30 or 31 as the case may be. So everywhere you should have the determination of competitor and same quality. For example, I am using Chandrika soap and I want to share the Chandrika soap for Medilix. Both are medical soaps. So in that case, the value will have to match accordingly. Then if the value is not matching, then you will have to resort to rule number 30 or 31. Value of supply of goods, services, both between distinct person or related person. Same slide. So, for example, value of supply, if market, open market value is determinable, then the open market value will decide the rate. If open market value is not determinable, then value of linked like kind quality. Then when it is not also cannot be determined, then you go to follow rule number 30 or 31, provided will continue in the next slide. Provided if I am supplying goods to my branch, a distinct person buys goods for further supply, then I can claim 90% of the value as cost. If I am raising stock transfer invoice on my branch and collect tax and remit, then be eligible for full ITC, value of invoice is equal to open market value. Customer price 10,000, so I will have to charge accordingly. The same example for agent. Value of supply is OMA available, then open market value. If it is not available, 90% of the value of customer's price, like kind and quality, cannot be determined. So follow rule number 30 or 31. Value of supply of goods received through agent. Who is an agent? Agent is he's working for a principal marketing the goods in the in his place. Both are assumed to be living in a different state. In this transaction, if it is a normal sales, it is 4,550. The sale value is 5,000. Then 90% of 5,000 will be 4,500, or I can adopt the normal market rate 4,550. By doing this, I can transfer the goods and I can claim the input on 90% of the value. Then I can pay output tax and adjust the difference, whatever we will have to pay from my pocket. Rule number 30, value of supply cannot be determined by the earlier rules. Value is equal to cost plus 10%. Then if that also cannot be determined, reasonable means. What is reasonable means? reasonable means is that you love to adapt to the place, that is a competitive rate, then you love to do the transaction. Special supplies, exchange, then your flight ticket, life insurance, second hand machinery, gift voucher, notified service providers. Wonderful provision. The currency exchanger is also liable to be taxed. One of the currency is rupee and the other of the currency is rupee. That is, I am exchanging dollars for rupee in the first instance. I am giving euro to for the dollars. So that is the second issue. Then how will the rate of tax will be there? Value is equal to RBI reference rate minus buying and selling rate into total number units of currency. If you don't want to calculate this, it is very easy. You can have RBI rate is not available, value of 1% of the gross amount of exchange. Either currency. That is, in the case of the RBI is not having the rate, then 1% of the lesser value in the RBI rate. Say for example, actually the euro is 78 rupees and the dollar is 72 rupees, means you have to take 72 rupees as the basis. Option available to supplier. Normally, the exchanger can opt for 1% rate, that is, from the exchange rate of 250 to 1 lakh, he can charge 1%. From 1 lakh to 10 lakhs, he can charge 1000 rupees plus of percent on balance. From 10 lakhs and above, he can charge 5500 plus 1/10 of the balance. Maximum ceiling is 60,000. You can opt any one of these options. And it cannot be withdrawn in the set financial year. It should be followed in the set financial year. Next year, you can change the option. For one transaction, you cannot go for 1% rate. And for another transaction, you cannot go for this option available to supplier. Air ticketing. That is the area which is affected by COVID to a larger extent. Because from March, the flights are not moving. And whenever there is a domestic flight, the person can pay 5% of the basic fare. Agent can pay 5% of the basic fare. If it is an international flight, it is 10% of the basic fare. Unfortunately, due to COVID, the hospitality, that is the hotels and the restaurant, then that is the transporters, all are affected because of COVID and they are all facing the time of closure. One of my friends who was working with the transport company, that is a company which engages for booking of ticket and getting a visa and other things, passport, etc. In the month of March, his salary was reduced by 30%. I don't know what is the present salary now. He may or may not draw the salary. You will have to check whether he is on the roll now. Life insurance business. The insurance business, only the company will pay tax. The agent will need not pay tax. It is called as reverse charge mechanism and company will pay tax on the gross premium minus amount allocated for investment. It will pay tax. In case of single premium annuity policy, other than A above, 10% of single premium, then all other cases, 25% of premium or 12% or 5% of the premium. The last situation is as same as your Income Tax Act. Income Tax Act, if you get the first year premium, you can claim discount up to 25%. And in the second and third year, you'll have to claim 12.5% as discount. Second hand machinery. Whatever second hand machinery, when you are selling except vehicle, so whatever value you are selling, you will have to pay tax on the you should not have claimed ITC. Whatever rate you are selling the commodity, you will have to collect the respective tax. But for the car automobile industry. During the 2017-18, there are two major losses. One is under VAT, where you have to charge 5%. Second one is between 17 to 19-11. In that period, you will have to charge the normal rate. If you are selling the imported car, then it will be costing you 42% as your tax. Then after that, after 19th, they have brought another method. You pay tax on 66% of the value. Then from February, they have changed everything and said, when the car or automobile sold beyond the book value, whatever the difference between book value and the sale of car will be liable to tax. If it is sold below the book value, then you need not pay tax. You can ignore, but you have to show this sales as second sales, exempted sales. This is a wonderful example. In the flat, it will happen. One day morning, the person is having the key, but car is not available. When inquired, the finance company told them, you have not paid 3 months installment. So we have taken the car with our duplicate. So they will sell the car and close the loan. In that case, they will have to reduce 5% for every quarter of the year. So, say for example, after 6 quarter, the car is sold, means 6 into 5, 30% of the value should be taken out. Then for 70%, they will have to pay that. This is a wonderful provision, vouchers, tokens, stamps. You have to know the difference between vouchers and the tokens and stamps. For example, in the marriages, everybody used to gift the clock and the tea set. Normally, that clock and the tea set will be reused. It will be given with a fresh packet to another person. When they get an invitation, it will be transferred to another person. So, I want to avoid that. What I have done is, I have I have paid money, I have got gift voucher from a departmental store and gave the gift voucher to the couples. They can purchase anything. They can purchase taxable goods or rice or whatever necessities they can purchase. When they purchase, the taxation on voucher will be based on that. For example, I have given the gift voucher from Big Shopee. When they go and purchase in the Big Shopee, they can purchase scent and also rice. They can purchase cosmetics. When they purchase cosmetics, they have to pay 28% tax. And when they purchase rice, they need not pay tax. They can purchase for the entire value of the voucher. The voucher will be taken at the time of redemption of the voucher. But at times, I have got a voucher from Titan Showroom. The Titan Showroom have given me the voucher. You can purchase only clock from the voucher. It can be wristwatch or clock, whatever the case may be. The commodity is identified commodity in this case. So whenever I purchase the gift coupon, the person who is giving the gift coupon will pay tax at the rate of 28%, because for watch it is 28% tax. So it is the unassigned goods, it is based on the redemption. If it is assigned goods, then it is based on the assigned goods. And at times, they give discount like paper, in the newspaper, they will give insertion. If you take that insertion, then they will give you 5% discount. So those will be, the transaction will be accounted for only on redemption basis. When you submit the advertisement, you can get the concession. Between distinct persons is of the same group. Then value is equal to nil to be notified. It is not notified as such. In case of exchange of barter, what is barter? It's a wonderful definition. That is the origin of trade. When the trade is commenced, I procure, I manufacture rice. My friend manufactures dal. Then I will exchange my rice for the dal. Some portion of my rice for getting the dal. So this is the called as barter. Exchange of goods for the value at some point of time. So the GST will not leave even the barter. They will levy tax when the goods exchanged. Actual value of goods higher than the amount received for such exchange, then you have to pay tax accordingly. So kindly note, the GST will be applicable on value in the consideration of rupees or value in kind. Say for example, I am doing an audit of a company. And the company says, after completion of the audit, we will provide you 2 days stay in Ooty. They give the gift coupon to me. My consideration is not my fees. In addition to that, I have got some staying concession from the party. That will also be included in the total value to arrive at the tax to be paid by me. Lottery ticket is not available in many states, but in Kerala it is available. When the state government runs the lottery, it is 100 by 112 into face value of the ticket. You will have to arrive at the value, then pay tax accordingly. If it is sponsored by the state government, authorized by the state government, and some other is doing the lottery ticket business, then it is 100 by 128. Price notified in the official kitchen, whichever is higher. This is the wonderful definition. We are not leaving the gambling. The gambling also liable to tax on the 100% face value. Actually, what happened once one client was ready to take the bookie in race course. And presently in Tamil Nadu, race is not conducted. Then that too in Chennai, it was abolished in 1970. So what they do, the horses will be running in a different place and the TV will be showing. You have to bet which horse will be. That is the betting tax. So the bookie will book the tickets, and when the horse which you have booked has won the race, then you will be given gambling for that. That gambling amount is liable for betting tax under gestural sales tax act. Then it is, whenever there is some tax collection in the gestural tax, the present tax will not leave that. They will also take it. So the concept is taken from that, and amount paid to the totalizer who at the time of payment is also liable for that. This is a wonderful example. An agent is appointed by Amar. His name is Anthony, and Amar appointed Akbar as an agent, and Akbar on behalf of Amar purchases from Anthony. What Akbar has done is, I have authorized Akbar to pay money to Anthony. He has paid the money, then he has got the book for me. The amount is mentioned separately in the invoice raised by Akbar. And Akbar has spent 100 rupees in claiming the same. Rupees 100, not a price extra. It is shown separately as incidental expenses. So for this, he is not liable to pay tax because he is a good agent. In addition to this regular sale, nice guy. If the value is added to the bill, then Akbar is not a pure agent. He is an agent who has added the profit margin for the expenses incurred. In that situation, he will have to pay tax on the profit margin. Enters into an agreement and incurs expenditure and or cost in the course of providing service, does not hold the title of the goods because the title of goods is with Amar, receives only the actual amount spent. Reimbursement, under that is a wonderful definition, expenses reimbursed. when it is reimbursed as pure agent, it is not liable to be GST. For example, I am going for a bank audit and the bank books the room for me and they take the payment, they make the payment directly to the bank. In that case, I am not liable to GST. Why? Because I am not going to get reimbursement of expenses. They have paid on behalf of me directly. But if it is another case, in the first instance, the room will be booked in the name of the bank and also my name will be available. Second instance, I am booking the room in my name and claim the reimbursement of expenses. So when I claim the reimbursement of expenses, it is liable to GST as per the GST Act. Because generally in this type of second transaction, there may be profit margin which is hidden in the work. I have completed the valuation of supply to the full extent. Then we will go to job work. Job work, very interesting topic. Meaning of job work, job to business model, registration of job worker, documentation, transitional provision. Why I am talking about transitional provisions here? Because for the 17-18, some persons would not have filed their annual return. In that case, they will have to know the transitional provision. The section which discuss with the definition of a job worker is section 2 of the subsection 68. Transitional provision 141. Input tax credit 19. Job work procedure 143. Delivery challan 55. Job work means any treatment or process undertaken by a person on goods belonging to another person, and the expression of job worker shall be construed accordingly. That means it is an enlarged definition which includes everybody, and every work done by the job worker is included. In the erstwhile regime, the job worker will not pay tax. He will try to avoid tax, but now in the present scenario, he will have to make tax. Model 1. Sending the goods to the job worker and getting the materials purchased and transferring the materials purchased to the job worker, and the job worker receives the goods. I will claim input on the materials what I have sent to the job worker, and the job worker turns back the goods after processing. If the job worker is registered, then he will raise an invoice on me. If he is not a registered dealer, I will have to pay tax on the RCM. RCM is reverse charge mechanism. But now this system is not available because RCM is layover for 9-4. The next method is, I am sending the goods directly from the supplier to the job worker. Job worker receives the goods and the bill will come to me. Based on the bill, I can claim the input tax credit. Then at the same time, job worker will manufacture the goods and return me the finished goods. I can claim input on the goods manufactured by the job worker, charges charged by the job worker if he is a registered dealer. If he is not a registered dealer, I will have to pay tax on the reverse charge mechanism. Third system is very wonderful provision. It is done by most of the manufacturing unit where the manufacturer engages the job worker and sends the goods to job worker. Raw materials will be sent to job worker. Job worker will undertake the work, and after completion of the work, he will send the goods directly to customer. By this, the time is not wasted and the movement of goods is not wasted. For doing this, there is only one condition. The manufacturer should register the job worker place as his branch. Then only he can do it. Claim of ITC on input sent. He can claim the material. Whenever the material is sent, he can claim input tax credit. Can send the collect and send and collect back goods without GST. Job worker will charge GST on the invoice, and that GST also can be taken as input by the manufacturer If he is not a registered dealer, manufacturer will pay tax under us. The next method is I am asking the supplier to raise the bill on me and deliver the goods to job worker. Job worker will do the job work and after that he will send the goods to the customer. Here I will have to register the place of job worker as my registration place. Then I can bill and send accordingly. Job work is a service. So when the service is 20 lakhs for normal states, when it exceeds the 20 lakh conversion charges exceeds 20 lakhs, he will have to register. Or if the income exceeds 20 lakhs, he will have to register. In case of interstate job work, threshold limit will not apply. Job worker will pay GST on labor charges if registered. Manufacturer will pay GST on RCM. And there is some amendment for job worker, and when they do the interstate job work, they need not register now. For the jewelry, the job worker rate of tax is 18%. Jewelry, the rate of tax is 3%. So, for the manufacturer of jewelry, they will have to pay 5% as job worker. Input tax credit can claim ITC on goods sent for job work. On goods used by job worker also, they can claim input tax credit. Goods used by the job worker will add the cost to the conversion charges and claim the tax. I am sending the goods to my job worker. I will have to get back the goods within 1 year from the date of sent of the raw material. I will have to get either raw material or finished goods within 1 year. If not, the transaction will be treated as a supply in the hands of job worker, and I will have to surrender my input tax credit. In the similar scenario, when I send a machinery for job work in the job worker's place, the machinery should come back to me within 3 years. If it is not coming back to me within 3 years, then I will have to treat it as a supply and I will have to pay reverse my input tax credit on the machinery. Delivery challan. Delivery challan is a wonderful document for movement of goods. When it is between the job worker and the principal, and principal sends the goods, he will prepare a delivery challan and send the goods. And when job worker turns the goods after conversion, he will prepare a delivery challan and send back the goods to principal. The delivery challan will have the date and number of the delivery challan, name and address of the consignor and consignee, then HSN code and description of the goods, quantity, then tax rate, taxable value, tax rate, and the place of supply in case of interstate movement, and the signature. Signature is a wonderful document in the tax invoice. If the tax invoice is not having signature, the input cannot be claimed by the other person. Normally, it is our procedure. Whenever we generate a computerized invoice, we will say it is a computerized invoice. It need not have signature. But under the GST Act, the signature should be either physically or digital signature should be marked in the invoice so that it is eligible for input tax credit. It is given in 3 copies. One copy for the original for the consignee, second copy for the transporter, third copy for the consignor. The job work for these industries are 5%. That is printing of newspaper, textile yarn, fabric, garment, jewelry, printing books, printing of all goods falling under chapter 48 or 49, processing of hides and skins leather. They were reduced from 18 to 5%. In case of newspaper, there is your constitution does not permit you to charge tax on newspaper and electricity. But for printing the newspaper, it is a job work. They can have the job work charges. If the newspaper, in the morning the newspaper, you cannot charge tax. But if you are giving the newspaper in the afternoon as a waste scrap, it is liable for tax. Manufacturer of leather goods or footwear, all food and food products, all products under Cap 23 of Customs Tariff Act, manufacturer of clay bricks, manufacturer of handicraft goods. Wherever the rate of tax is 5%, they have reduced the transaction to 5%. Tailoring contract and manufacture of umbrella, previously 12%, subsequently from 13-10-2017, it is reduced to 5%. Printing work, there are 4 or 5 types of taxation. Services on goods belonging to another person, printing of newspaper, books, including Braille books, journal, and the periodicals, it is 5% tax. Services on goods belonging to another person. Say, for example, I order for visiting card or invitation for my daughter's marriage. Then they will charge me 12%. Any ancillary services in relation to printing, 5%. Normally, when the job work material supplied by publisher, the similarly, the scrap which is arising in the job work can be sold by the job worker if he is a registered dealer. If he is not a registered dealer, the proceeds will be informed and given to their principal. He will have to raise invoice accordingly. So, in my presentation, I have taken a scope of supply, definition, time, place, value, and job work. I have completed, and this is thank you from me for the patient hearing in spite of the disturbance of internet and etc. If there is any doubt, I will answer the doubt immediately now. Thank you for the patient hearing and thank you for the opportunity.
Respected yes, sir. Thanks a lot, sir. It is our pleasure having you for the today's session. And I want to thank you for supporting us while facing technical errors. Yes. And about the today's session on supply and its types were explained in more detail and simple form, which all would have easily understood. Being an eminent chartered accountant, your lectures were more informative. Each and every example for the concepts have given us deep down experience, and it was so phenomenal. On behalf of every participants, I thank you for making this day more knowledgeable. Looking forward for more such sessions from you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity, Mr. Jagadishwaran, sir.
Sir, there were questions in the chat box.
Can you read the questions?
Yes, sir. So, what is zero-rated system, sir?
Yes, very good. Tell me, madam. The supplier, that is the employee, is doing service for employer based on the agreement which was entered earlier. For example, I have taken a clerk in my office and I have asked them to prepare the books of accounts for my office. And I said I will pay some tax, some amount, others I will pay them 20,000 rupees as remuneration per month. In this case, there is an agreement between me and employer and the employee. Therefore, it is neither taxable service nor taxable good. It is coming out of the purview. In your trading profit and loss account, only your salary bonus are not liable for GST.
Okay, sir. So there is another question. Could you explain the actionable claims?
Actionable claims. Wonderful. Say, for example, I have one product. And for that product, I have not paid tax. They seize the product from me. And in case they want to make the payment, they auction the product and get back the money. In that, the actionable claim, I have the claim, whatever, when the liability is covered by the money, they will have to pay me some amount. And the insurance is one of the actionable claim normally given as an agent. I will come once again on 29th.
Okay, sir.
So whatever doubt you have, you can ask me on that day.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you for the wonderful session, sir.
Thank you, madam.